Okay, Shalom Aleichem, good evening everybody, and welcome to the beginning of our cookbooks course. Yes, people are asking many questions about Levi, put yourself on, shut your video off for 1 minute. People are asking questions about if they could be heard or seen. This is not Zoom meetings, this is Zoom webinars. And Zoom webinars, when you come in, you cannot be seen, you cannot be heard, only the instructors can be seen or heard. I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Yehoshua Wordy. I'm the director of the JCC Workforce Program. We've been in touch, many of you, by email. I want to apologize if you've been having a hard time. We have been actually overwhelmed. When we put out these courses, we had no idea how many people would respond. It's a tremendous response. We've been responding to emails nonstop and registrations, and Baruch Hashem, it's been just a tremendous response, but we weren't prepared for it and we're not staffed for it, so it's been very difficult for us to be able to reach everybody and respond in a timely fashion. So for those of you that might have had a hard time, I'm sorry about that. If you have any issues, you could always reach out to us. We'll do our best. We really have been overwhelmed with the response to these courses. So I'm excited that you could be here tonight. This is our QuickBooks certification course. A little bit about JCC Workforce Program before. We're a Brooklyn-based program. Our mission is to help people find jobs and career, help assist with career counseling. We're primarily funded here in the five boroughs. That's where our main mission is. So for those of you that are, you know, with the Zoom, we've opened it up to more people. But really, for those of you that would like assistance with career counseling, resume writing, or job placement assistance, you could reach out to us at any time. Just send us an email to the one you've been in touch with, and we will do our very best to give you that assistance. This particular course is a special course focused on QuickBooks, which is one of the very big in-demand skills for many office jobs. And you know, whether you're going to work in a company or you're working, if you have run your own company, of course you need QuickBooks to track your expenses. And it's a special, you know, special skill. This is an eight-week course, 2 nights a week, 2 hours a class. We leave special time at the end of the class for Q&A. So for those of you that have questions, feel free, you know, we're going to address them in a more specific way at the end of the class. It's also a huge class. As you can see, there's 76 students currently on. We're going to do our very best. This is really something very new for us, and I hope that all of you will have the patience and bear with us on this. Just one more thing I want to say. We call this a certification course because there is an option. If you take this course seriously and you learn everything that the teacher teaches you, at the end of the course, there is a certification test that can be taken. And if you pass it, you could get a certification in QuickBooks. So for those of you that want to take QuickBooks very seriously, please pay close attention to this. And we're going to prep you to be able to pass that test very easily, so long as you tune in and you take this course seriously. Without further ado, I'm going to introduce our instructor, who's really going to be with you the whole time. I really will only be in and out. Levi, you could turn on your screen now. Levi Zarchi is a friend, somebody I know for many, many years. He's a brilliant scholar, a Talmud Chacham, and he's a CPA, and he knows QuickBooks inside and outside, and he's going to be teaching you for the duration of the course. Of course, you have my email address. Please, at the end of the class, give me any feedback that you'd like. We'll try to take that into account so you have the most smooth and pleasant experience possible. This is something new to us. We've never done a Zoom course. We've always done in-person courses, but under the circumstances that we're in right now. So please, everybody, this is all new for all of us, and we'll try to do our very best. During the course, it's going to be interactive, and Levi will talk about that. You could send messages through the chat and Q&A, and there's ways to raise your hand. And, obviously, this is not just a video that you're watching. So, you know, this is meant for you to interact. You're going to download software. Levi will talk about all of these things. You know, this is the intro class. Hopefully, we'll try to answer all your questions. So it's been nice meeting all of you. You all have my email address if you need to reach me. Enjoy the course. Levi, you're muted. You got to unmute your mic.
Okay. Thank you very much, everybody. And I want to thank you for the opportunity to be able to present the QuickBooks course. We're going to start with an overview. Before we get back to the actual software itself, I'm going to give a little understanding of what it means to be bookkeeping. There's a small element of accounting that is a prerequisite to know. I'm humbled to see Kanina Hara, a very large attendance, and we have a question and answer beneath the screen, which periodically I will take a look if there are questions. Obviously, I cannot get to every single question while I'm talking. So if there are some lengthier questions that need to elucidate, we'll try to incorporate that into the next sessions. So first of all, the name of this of the program which we're doing is QuickBooks. I have a slideshow or PowerPoint, which I'm going to introduce in a moment. I'm going to share my screen. This is also in giving a new subject with electronica. Here we go. About a second. Share screen option. Share screen. Here we go. Welcome to QuickBooks. Okay, so we have here welcome to QuickBooks. QuickBooks is a software which, when they started, there was always bookkeeping involved in businesses, keep their financials. Those were all physical books. There were a number of books which were involved, as we're going to explain in the following slides. And what QuickBooks does is that it merges everything together in a way that it brings it, it saves a lot of time in transferring from one book to another book. And it's all computerized. We have over here the topics which we're going to discuss in QuickBooks is we're going to navigate the program. We're going to learn about the chart of accounts. Chart of accounts is actually the core. It's the essential part of QuickBooks because every transaction needs to be assigned to account. It's like account when you do the accounting. So QuickBooks has to know how to categorize the information. And the information that we put in is obviously transactions. There are many types of transactions that we do. We have banking transactions. We put money in the bank. We write out checks. We also have customers. Customers buy items. So we have to have customer information. We sell. We provide either services. If it's a service industry, if it's like a merchandising industry, whether it's a grocery store or any type of store which sells products, there are sales involved. And on the flip side, there are vendors and their expenses, because in order to sell things, we're going to buy them. And we have to keep track of all the people that we're buying for, who we're going to pay payments for. And some of the expenses are paid on the spot. Some of them are paid after time. And all these things we're going to explain as we go through QuickBooks. There's inventory. Some stores which sell very cheap items, so they just have an expense of their supplies and they hope that nothing is shoplifted and they turn a profit at the end of a cycle. But stores that need to keep track of inventory, whether it's more pricier items, whether they need to know when to reorder so they don't run short. So there's inventory tracking. Inventory, obviously you're buying it, you're purchasing it, but until it's sold, it's something of value. So it's not really an expense as we're going to see. It's just transferring some money that you have into items which you sell, or whether you didn't buy with money, you bought it on credit. All these things will be inventory. Then there are companies that do employees and payroll. It's possible in this course we'll deal with this if time allows. Many companies opt to have payroll services to take care of these things because this is a little, it could be complicated. There are a number of tax rules to know about, people coming, people going, and the amount, not every person in the office also has access to know what people's salaries are and employees are. So sometimes this is delegated to a payroll company. QuickBooks adjustments we'll leave for now. And obviously the QuickBooks reports, these are at the end, after we have in the transactions, we made our sales, made our purchases, we wanna know, did we make money or are we in the black or are we in the red? Hopefully we're in the black. We made money. And if we didn't make money, we have to see we're gonna analyze the reports. I'm gonna see what is really eating up our profit margin. Besides the profit and loss, which is popular, we also have what's called the balance sheet. That actually tells us what the company's value is. not just in this accounting cycle, let's say not what we made this year, but historically, how much money do we have? What do we own? What are our assets? Which all these things we're going to discuss in QuickBooks. I'm going to go through one chapter over here to introduce the books, and then I'm going to look to see if anyone has any questions on what we have discussed so far. So the books in the business. We have what's called the General Journal, which is also known as the Book of Original Entry. Now, why do you need to know about this? This, you know, we're going to learn later on in QuickBooks. But right now, giving the background, if you were a manual, if you were a business, a journal was like a diary. Someone would write everything which goes on in the store. Someone, a customer came in and bought something, they would put it down. If a vendor came and made a delivery and they wanted to get paid money, so you have to mark down that money went out. So you could keep track of everything that comes and goes. It's possible someone came in and bought something and didn't pay. So you have to mark down that it wasn't a sale of cash. You have to mark down that it's on credit. All this went into a journal. At the end of the day, the person will sit down and take his journal, and he'll have to sift through all the information. Because practically, when you have a diary, it doesn't tell you, it has all the going-ons of the day, but you have no idea really what happened financially. If you want to know how many sales you made today, you have to go through the whole diary and add them all up. And if you want to know how many bills you had that day, how many deliveries, how much inventory you got, this is all scattered throughout the journal. A business, you might, which is a mom-and-pop shop, might only have a few entries per day, but there are some days which are busy. You have larger stores which have many, many entries. So they'll sit at the end of the day to go through the journal, and they'll have to do a transfer process. They'll take everything, and they had a general ledger, which was like a master page, and that was broken down into different sections. They would have accounts receivables, money which they start to collect from customers, and again, there's a subsidiary ledger, as we'll get to it, why they need a subsidiary ledger, because you want to know each individual customer how much they owe, and you want to know the total. Same thing, you have accounts payable. You bought things and you didn't pay for them. You're going to need to know, again, what's my total outstanding bills, and then you also want to know each individual bill. In QuickBooks, this is all very easily, it's computerized. And you see one number, you could double click and it'll open up and you'll see what's beneath it behind the screens. But this is, you have to understand what the you say this, which is the foundations of the accounting. You have cash receipts. Someone just bought something. You wouldn't have to make a bill for it. You could just write down, you received money and you made a sale. And the same thing is you have sales receipts or just purchase receipts. And then you have also an inventory book, which is to tell you what do we have in stock? What is the total? Sometimes the inventory could be a few items, could be worth hundreds of thousands of dollars or even millions of dollars in large companies. You want to keep track of that. And
Lady,
yes?
Joshua, where are you? Just some, I'm looking at some of the comments. You should keep the chat open on the side. So yeah. There's people, first of all, asking you to speak a little louder. Your voice is not coming through so strongly. Second of all, I know there's people asking some questions. Keep the chat open on the side so you can see some of the questions people are asking.
Okay, 1 second. Q and A. I said, where am I here? Okay, fix the mic. Okay, the question, we'll get a certificate at the end of the course. This is, there was a question about getting a certificate at the end of the course. That was possible to get the certificate if you want to take the test at the end, or you just want to take the course to get the knowledge without taking a test. I'm going to try seeing if this headpiece works any better. So we're back to this.
speak now. There's been a lot of static. We've been hearing a lot of static. Speak. Let me hear you speak, please. Just for, you know, for some reason we haven't been hearing your voice. Speak now, please, Levy. I don't know if you hear me, everybody, but it seems like Levy has become frozen. Maybe there's an internet connection issue. Hold on one second. I'm sorry. This is a technical issue. Hold on one moment, please. Okay, everybody, there was some sort of technical glitch. Levy is logging out and logging back in. So just give him a minute here. I don't know what happened with this, but I will. Let me just see if I could. He just logged out. He'll be logging back in. So hopefully we'll continue in just a moment. Thank you for your patience. And thank you all for your patience. Just waiting for Levy to log back in. Yes, for those of you that have been asking, all the classes are recorded, and if you want to review them to take notes and to review what you learned, we'll make them available in Emirat Hashem. Okay, Levy's back. Okay, Levy, we speak, please, so we could test your audio.
Yeah. Okay, I'm here now. Do you hear me?
I do hear you. Yes. Try to put that mic as close to your mouth as you can, and fix your yarmulke. It's a little smushed by the by the microphone. Okay. Go ahead. Just to continue now.
Okay. Sorry about that technical issue over here. So. Okay, this is the general journal, and you will see this also in QuickBooks later on. This is where you would have the date, you would have the account title, which we're gonna discuss accounts later. And for example, this is when it will be filled. This is showing you the diary. You would have the year, the month, and this is where a person would write in first.
Maybe here, the screen, you have to share your screen. People are not seeing your screen.
Oh, one second, I showed it before.
Right.
Okay, we're back here. You see my screen now?
Back up, because no one saw what you were showing before. So just, yeah. Okay, go ahead.
You see my screen now? Okay. So this is a blank general journal. You'll see the date, you'll see the accounts, and the debits and credits, as I said, we'll discuss later on. So a person who's working on a manual system would fill out a diary. They would write the cash. They received $10,000 and they have someone who invested the money. Then there was a purchase. They got office equipment, but they bought it on credit. That's why they have accounts payable. And they bought office supplies. This they actually paid with cash. This is a whole diary going through. Then what they would have to do manually is they'll have to go over to a ledger, where you see here, and they would have to post it. They would have to transfer everything from the diary into sections. So they'll take one account, which is called cash over here. This is where they'll transfer the cash transaction into the cash part of the ledger. And to make sure that they didn't do things twice, there'll be a cross-reference. So they have a posting reference, which shows general journal page one. This is the general journal. And this is page one over here. And conversely, they would have to post in the journal that they transferred already. So like this, they know that the information was successfully transferred from the journal to the ledger. And they have actually a source where why they're putting this information in the ledger. So practically, they would not, once they entered information from the journal, they would not have to go back to the journal. They'll deal with the ledger, but they would have the reference if they need to look up the source. And as we'll explain later, the cash transaction over here ended up in what's called a debit section. Now, taking that longer diary, they'll have to enter things. They had accounts receivables because they sold something on credit. They have office supplies because they bought some supplies for the office. And then they have office equipment because the equipment is what they're going to use, like a computer, like a desk. The supplies are things that get used up. Actually, equipment could be, you have office furniture, which is the more expensive, is a $2,000 equipment for furniture, and accounts payable is which they bought something and they owe. That is what used to happen. Now we go over to QuickBooks and we don't have to deal with entering everything twice in a journal and a ledger and posting back and forth with references. We enter it in once, and QuickBooks by itself knows how to distill the information in a format that we can use it. And it will also present it into nice reports. I'm just gonna open up the question chat over here to see if we have any. Okay, I'm gonna stop share screen a second. The slideshow. Oh, here we go. Question answer. Okay, if anyone has any questions, you post it. I'll be taking a look at them in the next chapter to see if there are questions in what was discussed so far. Now, we have a count equation. It's not complicated algebra. It's simple as 1 + 1 = 2. We have here assets equals liabilities plus owner's equity. Assets are the things that a company owns, something of value. If it's not worth anything, you wouldn't really call it an asset. It's nothing to brag about. Liabilities are the things that a company owes. We have bills. We bought merchandise, we didn't pay for it. We have a store, we have to pay rent. So after we satisfy our liabilities, we pay off all the things we owe, then we have owner's equity, which is, that's what we really have to put in our pocket. Another way of looking at assets are something valuable that the business owns. In short, A equals L plus OE, assets equals liability plus owner's equity. Or if you say assets minus the liabilities equals owner's equity. It's very important to know there are two sides of the equation. There are things that are assets and everything else on the other side, liabilities and owner's equity. And it's very important when we are going to be in QuickBooks and we are assigning different purchases to accounts, we have to know, is it an expense or is it an asset? When you buy a computer, it's not really an expense on day one because you own the computer, which has value. But when you pay the utility bill, the money is gone because you paid for the utilities. So you would, in this equation, you would assume the assets will represent number two, and that equals one plus one. It equals the liabilities and the owner's equity. Sometimes it's not evenly divided. Liabilities is not always 50% of what the company has. It could be, but the idea is there are two things that together make up what the company has. Or two minus one equals one. Now, what are examples of assets? So the most liquid form of everything is cash. It's money. You can have it in the bank, you can have it in your cash register. All these things are things which the company owns. Just because you don't, when you log into your bank, you don't see that in the balance, but you still have to keep track. If you have a department store that has 20 registers and each one has $300 worth of cash, you still own another $6,000 of cash besides what's in your bank. And there has to be a way to account for that. Accounts receivables. So this is really a customer came to the store and spent $100 but didn't pay. He owes you now $100. So this is really something valuable because you hope to collect that $100. You don't have the money yet. You have it either in, it could be a notes payable, a notes receivable, where you actually wrote a note, or it could be that you have it on your computer, you have a customer file, and these are things which you're gonna collect on. So there's a question about the complete equation. For example, if someone puts $100 in his bank and he has now an asset of $100 in the bank, he now bought something for $50.
Maybe before you continue, just from seeing this live, everyone should post your questions only on chat. Forget about the Q&A stuff.
Oh, I was looking at the Q&A, so I'm looking at
Q&A? So maybe, we have to just choose one of them. You can't look at both at the same time. You never.
Right, there has to be one. I see chat has a little more.
Whatever one is going to be, and that's it. Going forward, you know, if you want to post a question, you choose which one you prefer, Levy. Q&A or chat?
One second. I just happened to see Q&A first when it popped up. Okay, so the chat is saying that this is better voice quality. QuickBooks, we're going to install on your computers following the session. I'm going to explain that.
Yeah, talk about it at the end of the class.
At the end of the class about the software. I just stopped sharing my screen. The second time we'll reshare it again.
Levy, I'm just saying, just choose one of the two, chat or Q&A, and just let everyone should run with that. Stay exclusive, because you can't look at two items at once.
Right. I see the chat keeps on running. You know, we could keep the chat, and I'll scan through it because there's a lot of posts, comments.
Scan through Q&A and chat together. It has to just be one. You'll never be able to.
Right, I understand.
So, going forward, which one do you prefer? The only good thing about the Q&A is that once you answer it, you can push a button and it'll disappear. With the chat, you can't do that. That's the two different. That's the difference. So which would you prefer?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I think we'll stay with the question and answer. If it's a question, I know it's really a question.
Okay, so everyone going forward, please, when you want to pose a question to Levy, just use the Q&A. Ignore the chat function. It's too difficult to do both of them. So, and everyone that's asking about the software, yes, you do need software. At the end of the course, Levy will explain how you get the software. So going forward from the next class, all of you will have software that you're going to use, because this is meant to be an interactive class. And with that, I sign. Levy, I'm off. So it's back to you.
Okay. Okay, there's a question regarding depreciation. Depreciation is an expense, not a liability. We will get to that.
Moshe, if you were worthy here. I just want to interrupt. I've been watching this go for a while, and it's nice to see how interactive it is. I just want to make a comment to all of you. You know, there's two vehicles for communication here. There's the Q&A and the chat, and they're both running. It's almost, you can't do both. It'll make you go crazy. You have to just choose, Moshe, whichever one you prefer better, the Q&A or the chat. And going forward, everyone should comment to you using only one of those.
Yeah, because I guess I can also see how many questions I answered, and then I'll see later on if I need to incorporate some of the questions into
you just choose one, and please, everyone going forward, we'll just use one.
I'm focusing on Q&A right now.
See everything. People are commenting that if there's chat, then everyone else could see the questions that everyone else is asking. So you decide. You're the instructor. You just have to choose one.
It looks like based on the engagement here, people have moved to the webinar chat, which is fine. I think there's some good collaboration amongst the participants as well. So I think we'll just continue with the webinar chat.
Okay, everyone, please stop using the Q&A then.
Just okay, you want to go to the chat?
March through the chat. I'm signing out now, so you're on your own. Enjoy.
Okay, so I think at this point, I would agree with Mr. Nachman Rifkin here that I'm going to go ahead and I'm just going to keep moving just to get some flow going on here. And, you know, I will, at the end of this,
someone's talking here.
9:30 or so, I think that's where we'll have some Q&A. Maybe actually in about a half hour, we'll take a little break. I'll answer a few questions, and then we'll just keep moving.
It seems like I'll be talking with someone else in the background over here. One second. Okay. So I'm trying to introduce every topic one at a time. Right now this is Levi Zarchi talking. So the question, liabilities are things that we owe to people. So if I, again, someone gave me $100 and lent me $100 for the business, I owe that person $100. I put the money in the bank, so my business has $100 in my cash, and I owe someone $100. My owner's equity is zero. So in this case, it will be 2 - 2 = 0, because the whole asset which I have, which is $100, was borrowed money. But if I have $50 of my own, actually the business never really has its own money. That's why when you take the owner's equity, it's the person who owns the business. So I borrow $50 from someone and I take 50 of my own and I put it in my bank, or for that matter, I put it in my cash register. The business now has $100. I owe someone 50 and I own 50. In this case, assets equal $100. Liabilities reduces that by $50. So assets minus the 50 equals 50, or assets equals 50 plus 50. I hope that clarified what liabilities was in this case. I am not screen sharing yet. I'm not moving forward. I was answering a question. Now, someone asked regarding depreciation. So if I buy a computer for $100, if I have a computer for $500 and it goes down in value, I don't owe anyone any money. It's not a liability. I bought my computer. If I paid for it, I own it. If I didn't pay for it, I still owe the same $500. So depreciation, which is the decline in value, does not enter as a liability. What we're going to do, we'll get to the depreciation later, because we're not holding there yet. I'm going to go back to the slide now. I'm going to share screen. We're going through the different types of assets that a business can have. We have cash, which is actual liquid. Accounts receivables is also liquid form, hoping that your turnover, it's possible the person is not delinquent. It's just that you give credit for 30 days. But you know, in 30 days, you will have that cash, hopefully. because if the customer comes back and wants to buy again, you're not going to sell them. So cash is the most liquid form. Accounts receivables is what's called, current assets, which is as opposed to a house which you own, but you might put in the market and you get stuck for a year trying to sell it, then you can't make money out of it. So it's a fixed asset. It stays there. It's hard to convert to cash. It's not easily converted to cash as accounts receivable. We have, back over here, we have inventory. Again, we said inventory is not an expense. Inventory is an asset. If I made an order at a grocery store and the truck just delivered to me today, you know, all different types of items, dairy and produce and meat, and it was over $10,000, and I wrote him a check for $10,000, that's not an expense. This is an item of value. Again, we said assets are something of value which we own. When I sell that item, then I have to account a certain portion of that sale as actually an expense. Because, for example, if I bought, it cost me a bottle of milk, $2, and I sold it for $3. So when I bought it, I paid $2 cash, and it's called a conversion of assets. I converted cash into inventory, $2 bottle of milk. And it's not an expense. But when I sell it for $3, so now I have a $2 expense because I lost a bottle of milk. But I got a $3 income. So I have a $3 income, which the person paid. I have $2 expense because that inventory item went out. And what's left? The $1 of profit, which I have. That's called income. Second here. I'm introducing all the types of assets we have. And when we start going into QuickBooks and everything else, we're going to divide it. We're going to do service business and merchandising businesses because that is a totally different subject. It's much more complicated. It's once you have a good understanding how service business works, so then we'll be able to understand later on in the software how to deal with all the inventory. And they call it, when we sell it, it's called the cost of goods sold. But I'm introducing the assets. Now, that's, again, you have cash and you have inventory. Cash is money in the bank or anywhere in my business where it could be in my pocket. It doesn't have to be the register. All the salespeople for the day brought in their registers. It's sitting in the safe, not in the bank. It's in my safe. It's still cash. Accounts receivables, it's non-cash form. This is money owed. I want to receive the money. And inventory is items which we bought for sale. Inventory is not an expense. We hope to sell it and make money. Supplies are items which are used up. Now, what would happen in a service business? So in a service business, there it's not an asset. What a service is, if I am going to offer consulting services for $50 or $75 an hour, so if I did that consulting for $75, and someone paid me, now I earned $75 of income. I could put it in my cash, I could put it in my bank, whatever I do with it. There's no inventory and service. Service is the service that I do. Same thing is if the person didn't pay me, so I supplied a service, I have accounts receivable. We have income. We'll get to the income a little bit later, but what we know is if I worked, I earned money. Someone owes it to me, the customer owes me $75 for being tech support on this, doing this computer or over the phone. Now I have accounts receivable on him for $75. And that's the way it would work in a service business. The relationship between someone's asking between cash account, the different accounts, we're going to get to. Right now I'm introducing one account at a time. Now, it's a very good point which you're mentioning about the relationship. That is actually why we need to have this accounting equation. We have to make sure, this is also known as the double entry method of accounting. This was invented in 1494 by some Italian monk. And the irony, which was said is possible, that once the Jewish people were kicked out of Spain with the Inquisition, and or all the countries, and the church was taking over large amounts of monies and properties from the Jewish people. They had to have a way of keeping account for it. So they didn't want to count things twice. They had to divide everything up. What is the cash? What are items of value? It could have been jewelry. It could have been houses that they took over. It could have been other items. It could have been paintings, things that they couldn't transport. So that's the relationship between the accounts. In the owner's equity is included income and expense. Again, assets are all the things which we own as value. Liabilities is what the things that we owe. Owner's equity is what's left. What is I worth? That could fluctuate with income and expense accounts, but the income and expense accounts are usually tied to either a liability or some other service. I have which we'll get to in the following screen. Supplies generally are things which are meant to be used up, but it is an asset. Why do we call supplies an asset? Because when you buy $10,000 worth of supplies, because I'm a big shipping company, so you're not going to say right now I have complete supplies expense. Supplies is maybe a more liquid form of inventory. Some of it gets used up. Some of them could get ruined. Supplies is not always accounted for. Sometimes at the end of the year, you'll make adjustments. You'll see how much did I buy in supplies, what's left. And whatever is missing, that will be expensed later on as an expense. Yeah, furniture and equipment for the office. Machinery, it could be a copy machine, it could be built-in machinery. If you're having a print shop and there's things that are built in, so that's not, you wouldn't really call it so much equipment, which is portable. It's built in and you can't move it. You have vehicles, all these things that the company owns. You have land, you have buildings. This is a sample of assets. Going forward, we have liabilities. Liabilities could take many formats. One second. I believe my screen is being shared. If it's not being shared, someone should please comment. So you have bills, all types of bills. You have utility bills. You have rent bills. So once it's paid off, the liability is zero. The way it's paid off, you take cash and you write out a bill, and the bill is not there anymore. And payroll, so payroll is people working in the company again. It builds up during the week, and once you pay it, the payroll account gets reduced. So depending on if you pay people off, some people are on weekly cycles, some people are on bi-weekly cycles. But liabilities, it's always a fluctuating account. It doesn't stay still. We're going to learn later when we go to the actual QuickBooks, we'll see there are some accounts that are permanent and some accounts that are temporary. So bills and payroll, you might think it's temporary because you pay it. But the truth is, it is really a permanent account, because at the end of the year, you have to see the outstanding bills don't go, this doesn't disappear. The balance stays there. Same thing, unpaid payroll. No one's saying thank you very much for what I got paid till now, the rest I'm giving you back as a gift. So the permanent accounts is the balance stays open. With income and expense, however, at the end of the year, once you know how much you made, that account is not there anymore. You know how much you made for the year, and that income account becomes zero. It might go into retained earnings, which is an account where you could see year after year how much money you made, but when you look at net income, you look at net income for the year. Unless you could take a report for 2 years to see how much you made in 2 years, but income and expenses are usually temporary accounts. You can have loans. You take a mortgage. It could be a short-term loan. Someone lent you money to invest in the business. It could be bonds. Bonds have to be paid off. It's another way of borrowing money on interest. It could be a secured loan, and there could be mortgages. These are, I'm sure if you think about it, you could come up with other types of liabilities, other assets, but these are klalim, these are general categories of assets and liabilities. Okay. sometimes you don't always think about this, but lawsuits and judgments. You can have a bill that's only at a judgment, you owe the money. Lawsuits might be pending liability. Hopefully you win the lawsuits and you won't have to pay it. But there are times which you have to keep track of the lawsuit to when you allocate funds to know if you have to borrow money to cover it, because no one wants to be called in on a lawsuit and not be able to pay for it and have to liquidate assets within a period of time, then you're selling them below value. When you have time to plan for your expenses, then you're always safer. Okay. You're not expensing the cash account when you buy the inventory. You are, when you buy inventory again, you are taking money out of the cash account, but it's not an expense until it's sold. Now, there could be prepaid costs. Let's say someone, you know, usually you pay insurance, and if someone's on a car insurance, you're paying on a 6-month plan. Every month, it's an expense, it's gone. What happens at the end of the year, you were told by insurance company, I pay 6 months, you got a reduced amount. That could be a prepaid expense. You're paying insurance right now, not only for this month, but for the following 5 months. So we're not gonna get into technicalities of accounting right now or for tax purposes, but for an accounting perspective, this is it's an asset. You have 5 months of prepaid insurance. If you sold the business to someone and the car wasn't the name of the business, so now the person doesn't have to apply for insurance anymore. He has 5 months of paid insurance. So again, if we look at assets as something of value that a business owns, prepaid insurance for 5 months is not an expense, it is an asset. Is prepaid sales a liability? If you could clarify the question. You could prepay for something before it comes. So it's not a liability. You own the item. You could have bought furniture, it didn't arrive yet. You own it. If it doesn't arrive, you might make a claim with the vendor, but you own the item when you bought it. You would be taking money out of your cash account, or in this case, it could have been you have a credit card and you made an expense on the credit card. And now the company has an asset for that computer. It's not really an expense. So I think when I discuss prepaid, I think some of the technical questions we'll leave as we enter things in QuickBooks, you'll be able to see the relationship between accounts. Right now, I'm still introducing the accounts for themselves. What is cash and what is a bill? What happens when you take cash and you pay a bill, and the relationship, you take cash and you pay, for example, payroll taxes, that is part that we're going to discuss later with the debits and the credits was part of the ledger and the journal, which I showed you, but we're jumping ahead of ourselves. But what I said about prepaid insurance, I said, if you come the last month of the year and you prepay 6 months of insurance, technically that current month is an expense because it's gone. And the next 5 months of the new year is an asset, and you'll take the expense next year. Now, what is owner's equity? So we have, again, the same assets. Hopefully after we took away we satisfied all the liabilities. Owner's equity come cash capital invested. So again, if I borrowed money in the business, I needed, you know, the company itself, if you think about it as a person, as a fictitious person, that's a technical term for tax purposes. So the company has no money of its own. So there's two ways a company will get money. Either the person starting the company is going to inject his own capital, $10,000. So that's the owner's equity. There's no liabilities here. You put $10,000 cash and you have $10,000 of owner equity. That's the money you put in. Had you borrowed $5,000 from someone else and put in $5,000 of your own, that would be the case of the equation. The assets the company has now is $10,000, and the company itself doesn't really own anything. What it really is, it's equals the liabilities, the $5,000 which you borrowed from a third party, and the $5,000 which you put in of your own. And together, that's $10,000. So again, owner's equity is what the person owns. Again, not the fictitious person. We're talking, let's say, Ruvain opened a company called Zoom Consulting. And in order to open the business, he had to buy several computers. He had to get office space. So Zoom Consulting has nothing. So Ruvain is putting in $10,000 into the company. What does Ruvain have? Ruvain's equity in the company is the full $10,000. That owner's equity is what the owner, which is Ruvain in this case, owns in the company. If Ruvain had to borrow $2,000 from Shimon and put in $8,000 of his own, so Zoom Consulting has $10,000 cash, that's the asset, minus equals $2,000 of the liability from Shimon, borrowed from Shimon, and Ruvain has his $8,000, that's cash capital invested. And that, so you're always going to see on the balance sheet, it has to balance. It cannot be different. You cannot have an asset of $10,000 and the liabilities and owner's equity equals 9 or 11. That would be an incorrect, something happened. QuickBooks has protections against that. That when you make the entries have to balance. We're going to call everything debits and credits as we're going to go further. Debits have to equal the credits, and later on, the assets have to equal liabilities and owner's equity. And if not, then the computer is, the software is broken. But in this case, it's usually there's some, it's not going to let you get there. Articles of value investors. So owner's equity doesn't only mean cash. If I have my personal car and I want to open a delivery service called Zoom Delivery, so I'm investing my car into the business. So now my car has worth $5,000. The business has, in this case, will be machinery, a vehicle. We have vehicle asset of $5,000. It wasn't borrowed, so there's no liability. This is my equity is not the cash. My equity is the car. If the car gets into an accident and it's uninsured and the car was totaled, so the asset became zero. And automatically, the owner's equity also became zero because the asset became worthless. If the asset declined in value, I had a $2,000 damage, it's only worth $3,000. So the asset became devaluated by $3,000. There was no real expense here. It's in this case, we'll call it, there's a name for it, but it's the salvage value of the vehicle is now only $3,000 because it's a $2,000 loss. And now your owner's equity will be the remaining $3,000. I think owner's equity was adequately explained. And experience, experience is sometimes you have this in a company where we give value to experience. It might be called goodwill or other types of fancy terminologies. This is equity. If you have partners and you bring someone into a company, so the first two people might have invested $20,000 each, and their equity is $20,000. If they want someone with experience, they might transfer over $5,000 or $10,000 of theirs to the new person with experience. So now this person didn't really invest anything. He came with experience, but he's going to gain a portion of the owner's equity. Before we go over to debits and credits, if anyone has any, I'm going to assume that either everything's understood or everything's completely not understood. But I noticed there's some questions here. Again, there was a liquidation question. I think it's also premature. I'm Okay, thank you very much for the compliment. Mr. Cohen, I appreciate that. Again, from sometimes I have a tendency of talking fast, so remind me to slow down. Okay, so now we have the assets versus liabilities and the debits and credits. I don't expect everyone to get the debits and credits all in the first session. It could be complicated. There's a chart which would come along with it. It might take a couple of sessions to really get it. If you do get it, call a kavod, and you're from the lucky ones. So we're gonna repeat this several times as we go through. Non-tangibles are assets. It's called intangible assets. A patent is an asset. You can sell a company with still 5 years remaining of patent. It's an asset. Again, I gave right now examples of assets. When we go to QuickBooks, there's a chart of accounts. That chart of accounts is a generically created for any type of business you have. It will give you those chart of accounts, which you can add and customize however you want. So if you tell QuickBooks that you want Express set up, they're gonna ask you two questions to ask you what type of business is it? Is it a general merchandise? Is it a financial services? Is it real estate? Is it wholesale? Is it nonprofit? Because there are some standard accounts which are assigned. And again, those accounts are other forms of assets, liabilities, and owner's equity accounts, which will be in QuickBooks. Okay. Owner's equity is an experience of owner's equity. We're gonna get back to it with time when we're making entries in QuickBooks. Assets increase with debits. Because as we'll see in the journal, and we'll go back to the ledger. Actually, if you'll Google online, they still sell today journals and ledgers. You'll think you're in the computer age, but some people prefer, for whatever reason, to also have hard copies, and they like to, whether they're old school people and they didn't get computerized or not, you could still buy these sales books, you could buy ledgers. And the debit is always on the left side and credit is always on the right side. Debits are the left, so we have debits and credits. Asset is the left of the equation, incidentally, so assets will be debits, and liabilities are on the right side of the equation as owner equity and its credits. So if you want to know if your liabilities are going up, we'll be on the right side of the equation, which is a credit. Your owner's equity goes up, it's going up with a credit. When assets go up in value, it's on the left side of the equation and it goes up with a debit, and we'll see as we go along. So I'm gonna give you several versions. So again, assets increase with a debit, decrease with a credit. Or like I said before, assets increase on the left side and it decreases on the right side. So when you put money in your bank account, you'll be debiting your cash account. You'll be putting an entry on the left side. When you're writing out a check and taking money out of your cash account, so then your asset of cash is going down, is decreasing. It decreases with a credit, which is on the right side. Liabilities is the opposite. It increases with a credit and it will decrease with a debit. Now, income and expenses, as I said before, it's other ways of your owner's equity going up and down. And expenses, okay, we have income. Hopefully people like to have more income than expenses. Income increases with a credit, similar to an asset. So even though more income increases, your income is increasing, maybe your cash account, income could be increasing receivables if you didn't get the money, but income is on the right side of the equation. It goes up with a credit. Expenses, since it's the opposite of income, has an inverse relationship, so expenses will decrease with a debit. Again, if income goes up with the credit, income increases the credit, income goes down with a debit. Expenses is the opposite. It will go up with a debit, it will go down with a credit. I'm going to give it to you in another format so you'll understand that a little better. Right for now, I guess you'll have to take it as Zeta Sarcosov. This is the way it works. Debits are the left side, and assets go up with debits. You know, people usually know they have a debit card in the bank, and their bank account goes up with the credit. And when they use the debit card to take money out, making a debit to their account, they're losing money. Well, that's if you're on, that's on your point of view, but on the bank's point of view, anytime you're putting in money, they have a liability. They're owing you money. And every time you take out money, they're reducing their liability. So everything has two ways you look at it, but debits are recorded on the left. And what goes on the left side? Assets going up. What else goes on the left side? Expenses that go up. Liabilities that go down is on the left side. Income that goes down is on the left side. So liabilities and income are usually increasing owner's equity, because if you made more money, your value goes up. So just like money goes, your owner's equity goes down on the left side because your value goes down. Your liabilities, which is also on the same type of equation, goes down also on the left side. On the left side, if your income went down, your equity went down. On the right side, you have credits. I'm not sure if my Zoom chat is on the screen. Credits are on the right side. And what goes on the right side? We have assets going down and value. Expenses, reduced expenses. A reduced expense is similar to income going up, because at the end of the day, if I sold $10,000 worth of items, had $5,000 worth of expenses, my income, remaining income is $5,000. But if my expense is only $4,000, my income is now $6,000. So if expenses go down on the right side and liabilities go up, income also goes up and the equity goes up. We have here a chart, debit and credit rules. This is also taken from, give credit where credit is due. This is also from a college accounting book. You'll be able to see over here on the top left side, you see you have assets equals liabilities and owner's equity. This is the same equation which I gave you. And you'll see assets. So again, I'm reviewing whatever I said in the last 5 minutes, I'm reviewing with another sheet. We have assets, accounts. See, there's a debit plus. That means in order for an asset to increase, you do it on the left side and a plus. So there are two things to keep in mind with assets. Number one, that assets increase with a debit. That's a plus. A second thing to keep in mind, that where does the debit go? The debit goes on the left side. On the right side is a credit. Credits are always on the right. It doesn't make a difference. In all accounts, debits are left and credits are right. So whether you go to the liability account, you go to the owner's equity, debits are left, credits are right. But how to know what is going up and what is going down, so that you have to know that assets are the app on the left side of the equation goes up with a debit. Liabilities and owner's equity go up with the credit. They're in the right side of the equation, so they're, it's like a seesaw. When one goes up on one side, it goes down on the other side. And underneath owner's equity, as explained before, you have expense accounts, you have revenue accounts, which is income. Expenses react similar to assets. It's below the asset section. Expenses increase on the left side, and it decreases on the right side. And we'll leave drawing for now. We'll go on the right side of the equation, revenue. I'll give you all this chart. You'll be able to look at it and study it. This is condensing a number of the slides into one sheet. with several angles to view. It breaks it down with the equation assets equals liabilities owners equity. Underneath that, it has another chart showing debits on the left side, credits on the right, some are pluses and some are minuses. And then it goes down and it gives you another chart. What is debits? What are the credits? So these are three different angles or more. I'll give you the sheet. You'll be able to study it and at your leisure. I'm just looking here at the chat over here. Can you, more examples of why liability goes down with a debit and up with a credit. So again, with time, you'll get better clarity in this subject. But for now, we have to. I gave one opinion is that assets equals the other two. So since they're different sides of the equation, they have to be the opposite of assets. That theoretically, you might have argued that assets could have been all credits and liabilities and equities could have been all debits, but this is the way it was done. Now, I'll give you an example. Let's say you have a liability. Your landlord sent you a rent bill for $2,000. You didn't pay it yet. So, and since we're dealing with a double method of accounting, we're always going to have two entries, not one. One is going to be a debit and the opposite side is going to be a credit. That's how they balance. So we're going to have an expense of rent, for example. The expense of rent, if you look at expense accounts, it increases on the left side. An expense accounts, you debit the left, plus my expense of rent went up by $2,000. Automatically, the other entry has to be a credit entry. It's the right side because it has to balance. And that works good because liabilities go up on the right side with the credit. So I had a $2,000 expense of rent and a $2,000 liability because I did not pay it. We're going to see when we go over to QuickBooks, which after this slide, I'll already be introducing you to the general format of QuickBooks. So let's say now I would go ahead and pay that liability. How would that work? I would be reducing my liability. I have a liability of $2,000 now. I'm going to pay the $2,000. So I'm going to knock it out. So I'm going to reduce it with a debit. No more liability. Where is the credit coming from? The credit is coming from the cash account. And that also works. Makes sense. Because cash goes, you reduce your cash with a credit. So I go to my asset, I'm going to write out a check for $2,000. I am crediting my cash account, I reduce my assets, but at the same time, I am debiting my liability and there's no more liability. The same thing is if I didn't pay the whole bill, what happens if I only paid $1,000 out of the $2,000 bill? So again, originally I got a bill in the mail. So I enter a bill, $2,000. How would I enter it? So you could just, when you go into QuickBooks, you could enter a bill received from landlord $2,000. That's, you're only gonna enter one thing. But what's really going on behind the scenes, and it's important to understand that what's really going on, and this you would have done in the manual system, QuickBooks is doing this for you by itself. You are really debiting an expense of rent, $2,000. You're crediting a liability. Whenever there's a debit, there has to be an equally corresponding credit of $2,000. And when I go pay $1,000, so I am going to reduce that debit by that liability by $1,000. So I'm going to debit $1,000. I'm still going to have a credit of $1,000. I'm still going to have a liability of $1,000. But that when I reduce the $2,000 to $1,000 with a debit, I have to credit something for $1,000. What will that be? That will be my asset account, which is credit cash. Now it could also be that it's my last month of my lease and I had security. I had a security asset, I prepaid. So if my rent was $2,000 and I had a security of $2,000, I won't have to debit it will be an asset account, but I'm not crediting my cash account for $2,000 to reduce the rent liability. I'll be wiping out my security deposit. In this case, I will be crediting my security account for $2,000. I'll be debiting the liability for $2,000. I'm Chinese, debits and credits are Chinese. I will just go back a little bit to, if you would notice on the slide when I introduced the ledger, you see here a left side is debit and the right side is credit. This is a manual ledger. And if you go further, you have a whole chart of debits and credits, which you'll see here. There's every debit has a corresponding credit. Yeah, when you put money in your bank for 10,000, owner's equity went up by 10,000. When you bought office equipment, your asset went up by 3,000, but you bought on credit, so your liability went up by 3,000. Every debit has a corresponding credit. The original terms debit and credit, if you Google it, has some Latin origination of debit or creditor, but this is the way it's adopted in America. In English, it's debits and credits. QuickBooks uses the same notion, debits and credits. When you go to the ledger, you'll see again, debits and credits. This is the terminology that they chose to use. And probably in the expense account, people understand it the best. Oh, I have a debit, I have an expense from a bank, but in the bank account, that's the reverse of what intuitively you would think it is. Let me see where the chat is here. I'm not sure. No, debit and credit is not a gain and a loss. It depends where you are. If you debited an income account, that's not a gain. You reduced your income. Why would a debit to an income account be a gain? If my owner's equity went down with a debit, why would that be a gain? Not always you have a liability. It could be that the delivery came. I didn't make any entry for liabilities and bills. Right away, I wrote out a check. So automatically, this could be a shift, a shift in assets. If I bought a computer right away with cash, so I am debiting computer's an asset, and I'm crediting cash because I am reducing my cash. Again, we always reduce the asset with the credit. So right away, I'm crediting my cash, I'm debiting my computer. This is called a shift in assets. Not always the debits and credits have to be in two sides of the equations. You could have them on the same side of the equation. So if you would think on a credit card, it's actually more like it. You have a credit card, you make a charge. If the charge shows up on the left side, so your expenses are increasing. And on the right side, it will show you your payments that is reversing your balance that's owed. So you're not reducing your expenses, you're just reducing your liability. So if I get a utility bill in the mail, the expense is utility expense. It doesn't make a difference if it's electric, if it's gas. Water, by the way, is also utility. Sometimes you can also use a telephone as utility expense because it uses utility wires. Either way, the expense, the debit is expense, utility expense. The credit is cash because I took cash out of it. So the only thing you have to take away, if the only thing you go away with today in the debits and credits is that debits are on the left side and credits are on the right side, I would take that as some sort of success. You see that here in the chart, debits are on the left, credits are on the right. depending on what type of account it is, credit is a mila or chasara. And debit could also be a plus and it could be a chasara. Like Rabbi Wardy said before, about 15 minutes from now or so, there'll be more lengthy questions and answers. Maybe we'll be able to open up to live questions. If people want to ask that, that'll be fine as well. And we're definitely going to review this in QuickBooks, but I felt, from my experience, that getting a slideshow understanding of introduction to different types of QuickBooks, what are assets and liabilities, and what are debits and credits would be beneficial. Also important to keep in mind that QuickBooks has five general accounts, which we're going to get to shortly, and everything is a subdirectory of those accounts. I'll go back to over here. Chart of accounts. So we have here again, we have assets and fixed assets. These are both the assets. We have liabilities that we know before. We have equity. And we have income and expense. This is all we have. In expense, there are three types of expenses. There's cost of goods sold. Cost of goods sold, this is, like I said before, inventory is not an expense. If you made $1 million of sales, if you had $1 million of income and you spent $500,000 buying inventory, you would not be able to make a case that you only made $500,000 this year because you still have that inventory. It's still value. As you sell the items, that becomes cost of goods sold because they are removed from your inventory. So the difference between the sales price and your purchase price, that's your profit. Your purchase price is the goods, cost of goods sold. The sales price, like I said, if you bought a bottle of milk for $2 and sold it for $3, so when you bought it, there was no expense. You credited your cash or you, right? Or in this case, you credited liability, right? You have a liability with you owe money $3 and you have an inventory of $2 of milk. You sell the milk for $3. Now you have a credit of income $3. But you're gonna have to, a credit of sales of income. Sales $3 in credit. The expense will be cost of goods sold $2. And the dollar that's in between, that will be the income. You have cost of goods sold, you have selling expenses, you have operating expenses. Okay, this is it for the slideshow. I'm gonna go now over to QuickBooks. I believe you should have, since I'm sharing the screen, you should be able to see a QuickBooks over here. Okay. So whenever you're anywhere in QuickBooks, if you go Control A, it will bring you to the chart of accounts. Similar to when you're in a Word document and you want to highlight and select everything, you go Control A. Control A is a shortcut key to get to the chart of accounts. You have over here the type of account on the right side is the hierarchy. Again, think of the equation. We say assets equals liabilities and owner's equity. So we start off with assets. Over here we have assets, we have liabilities, and the owner's equity. Equity changes with income, cost of goods, and expenses. Okay, I'm gonna reshare the screen. It seems like they're not seeing a new share. Okay, with the share screen and QuickBooks. Okay, thank you very much for reminding me to share the new screen. I thought once you share the screen, you're done. If one person could kindly comment that they see the screen, and we actually thought of having a second device to see that what you see. Okay, so we have here QuickBooks. I mentioned Zoom Consulting just out of, we're actually doing QuickBooks Consulting, but I threw in a name, Zoom Consulting. We have our fixed asset, sold through on depreciation, we'll get to that. The only asset we have here in so far is furniture and equipment. And the balance is zero because we just started the business. There's nothing here. There is zero equity. Zero. As we put money, I'll show you how we put money into the company, how we pay bills. You're going to see how we write checks. You're going to see all the transactions that we spoke about before. And I'm going to show you the behind the scenes, the double entry. Because sometimes when you're making a report and something doesn't make sense, you have to take a look behind the scenes. There's a very interesting shortcut called Control Y. That will give you what the debit and credit is. Sometimes it's possible that you may have assigned it the wrong account, and that's why something is not adding up. I see this, the screen is small. We try to get a bigger screen, but let's see, control plus. One second here. I see actually a raised hand there. We'll have to find those hands. Chat. I'm going to assume that the chat is somewhere else besides the way raising the hands. Again, if you're looking from a cell phone device or an iPad, obviously it's going to be small. On the large, if you happen to be a computer screen, it'll be bigger because there's a lot of information. Before, I just had a slideshow and everything was large. We're going now into a software program, and there's going to be detail. There's going to be names of accounts, there'll be types, there'll be reports, there'll be numbers, and you want to get information on a page. I believe there's a view where I could enlarge the view, because this is a different type of view. You see it really small. Let's see how we can enlarge it a little bit. Okay, so the issue is that some people say that they see everything very small right now on the screen. When obviously if I click in a box, it's gonna get bigger. But I'm showing right now. So there are five categories which we discussed before in the equation. We have assets equal owner's equity and liability, or liability owner's equity, or the assets minus liability is owner's equity. Owner's equity is also affected by the income which come in, because initially, when you borrow money to start a business, you put in money, that's all you got. You got the liabilities and owner's equity. But when you're buying items and you're making sales, there are new things happening. There's income coming in, you're paying bills, there are expenses. All those affect the bottom line. These are the five general categories on the side. The left side of the screen over here is names, because in each one of these accounts, you're gonna have many names. So let's see if we go down example. An expense, advertising and promotion. If you would open up, there's nothing, there's zero activity over here because there were no advertisers, there's no data here yet for 2020. And if you remember what I told you before about permanent and temporary accounts. So when you see balance total over here in the center column, does anyone see do you just see the cookbooks, or you see also the mouse going up and down? So there's the zero balances. You see my very good. I'm happy to see mouse movement. The mouse movement is the balance is only on the permanent accounts. The assets is permanent. Whatever was my bank account last year, if I get more money, it's built on last year's money. It doesn't disappear. Liabilities, everyone wishes they disappeared, but they don't. Equity stays. But when you want to know a profit and loss report, you start every new year is fresh. So cost of goods, which is an expense, and all these other expenses come over here, these get wiped out every year. Obviously, if you go in, you make a report, you'll be able to see what your expense was for the year. We'll give you a total. And as we start making entries, because we want to put you know, a $200 ad online or in a journal. We're gonna start putting expenses because we're gonna need to buy insurance. We need to buy subscriptions. So we have here all types of expenses. Now then, these were I did not create. We told them we're doing a consulting company. So QuickBooks just throws in any type of generic account which they assume you might want to use, but you can always add new accounts. How will I add new accounts? Right here on the bottom. It says here account and new. And if I go into new, I'll go into a choice where I could choose what type of account am I adding. Is it income? Is it expense? Banks are assets. Loans will be considered liabilities because you're owing. And then there's equity. And then you also have different types of accounts, which that we'll get into at a different time. So first I'm going to make a summary of what we did so far today. We introduced that there are a number of types of books in the business. And don't think that's because you computerized, there's no more journal. If you go over here, I happen to have the accountant version open. You see right here, general journal entries. And there's even some general journal entries, which we'll get to at a different time. General journals is we still make the entries in a journal at times. We don't always do it. If you're writing a check or you're entering a bill, you will not use the journal. But there are times that you have to make journal entries. And QuickBooks by itself takes what I showed you before. We take the journal entry. We're going to post it into what's called a ledger. The ledger is the master account. The general ledger is broken up. You have asset accounts, which could be cash, credit card, you're keeping track. Someone might have multiple bank accounts. You know, if someone has $500,000 in cash and is uncomfortable with leaving more than $250,000 in one bank account, because that's all that's federal insured, he'll break it up and he'll give the bank accounts names. So even when you go into an account and you go new and you want to make a bank account and you go continue, you'll still give the bank account a second. You're going to give an account the name because you want to differentiate between, you know, if you have a good account in Chase or Bank of America or Citi or any other type of company, you're not going to give it the same name. QuickBooks will give you a report, a breakdown of every bank, and then the total of all your cash in hand. The same thing as if you want to keep track of other assets, of major, more than one building. So a landlord, you know, has several apartment buildings or several apartments, units or condos. So they might elect to keep track of the assets. You know, they want to see it's one company and they want to be able to, you know, keep track of what the balance is because things could go down in value. We'll discuss depreciation at another time. And the same thing is with sales. You might elect not to keep all the sales as one category because I could have a computer store. We sell hardware, sales hardware. Here it doesn't show you that it was hardware just because you were a report, but you saw where I double clicked that came out of hardware. I came software. I want to make a big to analyze my business. What is generating more income? Is it the software? Is it the hardware? And then you can have even software itself. You could break it down into different types of software or different type of computers. You want to know is IBM giving me more sales where I'm selling Macs and that's giving me more business. Then there's someone asked before about service business. We have right over here, support and maintenance. If I'm selling computers and I sell software and I'm also supplying technical support, I need to make money on all these items. I'm not going to tie myself up for life. I might have sold myself on a service contract for a year. It might have been a good deal. It might be a customer keeps coming back again and it wasn't such a good deal. But you will have a separate income line for support and maintenance. Shipping and delivery income. It's possible that you charge for shipping and delivery. This is separate from the profit of hardware because a customer who comes into the store and picks up their computer, for example, you're not gonna make the shipping money on them or the delivery. Maybe you could due to the coronavirus, you'll say we only do shipping and for the safety of everyone involved, then it's another way of generating income, it's a possibility. You might want, so that you're going to elect to break down your income, shipping and delivery. When you have, it's all about analyzing the data, being able to see all the components of income, because sometimes when there's a, if I'm going to decide to stop, to when I can't charge anymore for shipping because my competitor is giving free shipping, I want to know, so what am I really going to lose if I waive all shipping charges? And I had last year $2,000 of shipping income, I stand to lose $2,000 of income. So you might be able to say, yeah, we have free shipping, but we bought you somewhere else. We bought, we just raised the price on the technical support, etc. Yeah, online QuickBooks looks different from QuickBooks. The right now we are doing the software. It's possible we'll touch on the online a little bit later. There are advantages to online QuickBooks. Intuit, which is the producer of the engineers, software and engineers of QuickBooks, they're pushing the online very much because this is software as a service. They buy you in and you got to pay a subscription fee. And it never stops. They bill you month after month after month. And many times if you have more than one company, you're paying for the same service multiple times because each company is another account. When you buy your software, you know, there are companies that have can own 10 apartment buildings and they keep the books of each building separately. You pay software once and you have different files, we're going to discuss those in a future lecture, maybe one or two from now, how to open files, how to create files in QuickBooks. And you bought the software once, you don't have to go. So there are some people that we see that have software for 3-4 years, they don't even change, as opposed to paying, you know, every single month a subscription service. There are some people that are uncomfortable due to security reasons of having their data connected to the internet, you know, or on the cloud. They want to have it on their computers and their servers in the office. They might have backup encrypted, but they don't want to be dealing all the time going online. Every time there's a transaction to enter, you know, every keystroke is to be encrypted. You're relying on the encryption services of the companies that are working for you. But when you're working at home, you're just backing up a file. You're not sending over the information the same way. And there are other reasons why people might elect to have their financial data, you know, on their own computers and that on someone else's servers, which we don't have to get into right now. And right now in this course, we're going to concentrate on the software QuickBooks, which you install on computers. And that is, let me just go back a second, see any of the chat questions. Someone asked about a jewelry store. You have 3,000 different products. Okay, so yes, so we're going to discuss items in the next on Wednesday, Mitzvah Hashem. What we have here, hardware, that's or in a jewelry store, which is that's just general, because you could have you sell jewelry and then you have a service for setting this, you know, a stone in on the ring, for example. You might have you know, other types of services, polishing, or if you have a damaged menorah and someone brings it in. And you have a service for that. It's not an item, it's a service. So in the hardware, in the services, you can have many items and you can have prices for those items. And whenever you make a sale, you can enter a 2 or 3 or whatever code you want for that item. QuickBooks could quickly calculate the price of the item. If you've sold multiples, it does calculations. That's also one very good feature of QuickBooks. You know, anytime you're in QuickBooks and you can enter a number, it's a calculator. I'll give you one example. If I was writing a check to someone and I had 2 bills, to write a check, I have to have a valid bank account. So just for argument's sake, I'm going to choose Chase bank account, no particular reason. Now, I want to pay last month's water bill, this month's water bill, and I'm lazy. I know I look at it, I see it's one is for $50, one's $75. I can't do the math. So I'll just go right here, 50 plus 75. Automatically, QuickBooks did the calculations for me. It's 145. And if I was making the check to, for example, New York City Water Board, I don't have it yet, but automatically, I'm just going to do quick add as a vendor. We're going to go. We're going to do this again next time. And again, we had no. We probably have utilities. Of course, we have utilities. I didn't subdivide it into water, but I will in this case. Just for example, I'll show you next time when I do electric how I did that. But this is an expense account. It's utilities. So I might think I'm running through this quickly, but again, this is just summing up example of an entry. I just did utilities, water. Actually, utilities. Oh, I would have done it automatically. What is this? Name account I said was water. Should have automatically done a sub account of water, of utilities. Okay, so here we have it. The account name is water, sub account of utilities. Now, anytime I put in New York City Water Board, it's going to know utilities, sub account, water board. For example, for now I'm just going to write. Automatically, they thought I was making a check. If I'm doing check, I was going to print it. But if I decide it's a check number one, and do again New York City Water Board, I'm going to put in now $10. QuickBooks is very smart. Remembers that that the New York City Water Board is $10. There's also a feature that it can remember that I paid $125. In this case, you've crested on payments. I'm not paying online. I'm going to actually print later. Okay. In this case, let's go out of this. In this case, I don't want to remember how much I paid last time because you recall the $125 wasn't one bill. It was 2 months. One bill is 50, one was 75. So there are times where they have recurring bills, which you will want to QuickBooks to remember for you. If you're paying your car lease every single month, it will be the same. You can have QuickBooks remember what the amount is. That will show you another time. But there are times where you don't want it to remember. I'm going to pause over here right now. I hope this was beneficial. We welcome any and all feedback. Either I think some of you have my email address or through the portal. Okay, very confused. I understand. This is orientation getting started. Okay, you don't have to do it all in the chat, but I'm gonna type over here. I was gonna do it actually. I'm gonna share screen in big if people want to see. Let's go back to slides. Okay, I'll put this over here. Then after I copy it. Okay, so this is my email address, levizarchi@gmail.com. I probably won't be able to answer at length to the emails I'll get, but from the emails that I get, I'll probably be able to incorporate some ideas or seeing some of the questions people have into Wednesday's course. I didn't slide. I answered in chat, but now I'm going to do a second here. New screen share. New share. Okay. Back to the slide. Okay. One second. Actually, I have to go out of this. Just for argument's sake, we're going to insert in the slide. And here I'm just going to put in my email address. So I believe everyone can see my email address. You can copy and paste it. And let me see if I could, let's see if any new, now I have that Q&A. Liquidation, I don't know if someone asked about liquidation. We'll discuss more at length in the future. Lecture, but just in short, when you're taking something and you're getting any value out of it, so then you're going to have an expense, liquidation, whatever you're making out of it. If it was previously an inventory that was worth $10,000, but right now it's only worth $1,000, you had a $9,000 loss. There will be an expense for the $9,000, and an income for $1,000 on that. Let's look over here. Okay. So now we're presents. So this in presentation mode. I think everyone could see my email address. As I said, one second. I said I was going to give you this slide over here. This is probably the most beneficial thing to focus on before next class. I don't have email. I'm going to give Rabbi Wordy this picture, which he could email to you. That you could study. You'll be able to see the assets, liabilities, owner's equity. Again, you'll be able to see what goes up, what goes down, and how it goes up and how it goes down. Let me back up a second because I'm going to start looking at my. I'm starting to look at 9:35 chats to see what's going on, and if someone thinks I missed them out, let them please copy and repost this question. Okay. Why do you credit your cash account when you buy milk? Shouldn't you debit cash account and credit your debit? Again, just remember, anytime you're taking cash out, cash is an asset. Every time you're reducing your asset, you're taking money out, you are crediting. And the expense is the purchase. You purchase the milk. But like I said, if it's going to inventory to resell, then it's not an expense. It's you're crediting cash $2 and it's inventory $2. There are times that offices buys for the cafeteria milk for the coffee lounge. So then there is an expense. I'm debiting a cafeteria expense, $2. It could be milk, it could be cookies, it could be whatever it is. I'm debiting cafeteria expense $2 and I'm crediting the cash by $2. Let me go further down. Email was posted before and is also sent here. According to the class, I think you'll be in touch with Rabbi Wordy. Again, debits and credits. You don't have to memorize, but you can review. And we'll start next class by giving a quick review. I think the only thing that everything else will be probably self-explanatory. We'll review this sheet again before next class if anyone has any confusion. Thank you very much. It's 100% okay for that clear and everything, and it'll get clearer. Let me see. It's possible that I'll be able to get a couple slides out to print. Actually, again, this class was more in slide format. As we go further, we'll be sharing screens and doing transactions in, most of the time will be in the QuickBooks software. We'll try to test run to see what people are seeing. How small are they really seeing the data in QuickBooks? But there'll be much less slides. This was I use this as an overview, just as a as opposed to just talking. You see me all the time. I want to give you visuals. But every time it's possible to introduce a new concept, will be a slide. But I'm not sure how many more slides will be. Okay, regarding the software, we said we're going to discuss at the end of the class. Right now, my recommendation is we'll be sending out a link where you could download a free trial of 30 days for QuickBooks 2019. And after 30 days, you could get a trial of 2020. That's for people who just want to, it's 2 months, within the 2 months, you'll be able to evaluate and see how the software works. at no cost to you. Afterwards, you could decide what type of software you would like to have. There are a number of versions out there in QuickBooks. There's Pro, there's Accountant version, which I'm going to be using right now, and you could evaluate it for free. Everything has benefits. There's Enterprise, which I don't think you need to know. Eventually, you could buy QuickBooks for, you know, under $120 or so. QuickBooks Desktop Pro version. Accountants has a lot of features that they don't have, but I'm just using this to show some of the features that the Accountants version has. Again, this is a course that's going to get you acquainted with QuickBooks. No one knows from here going on what you plan to do with that. It's possible you'll be in a small grocery store for a while, managing their books, or in a busy office, and a wholesaler. You might end up being a bookkeeper for a larger company. Someone who is comfortable with numbers, this might push them on the road to becoming an accountant, or a full CPA, or just going to accounting school, which it's, you know, the sky's the limit. You're starting right now, learning a new skill. What you do with that, the potential is endless. There are endless possibilities. And like I said, for those that are trying to have the required software material for the class at no cost, they could be taking trial softwares. For those that know right in advance that they're going to take the Pro version, Desktop Pro, they could go ahead and buy it, and they'll install it once. Most of the terms that I see, the last comment that I see here right now, let me see. No, actually, it's not the last comment. Go down. I'm holding the 946 comment. We're getting there. Terms that were confusing. If it's a particular term, you can mention it or email it. But we're going to be reviewing all the types of books and ledgers, whether it's subsidiary ledgers, and there was we discussed. Where was the detail? Imagine you have 30 people, each owed you $100. The total outstanding that's owed to you is $3,000. So you need a snapshot view. What if people owe me $3,000? Then I have to have a collections report. I have to know who do I go after for that $3,000. So you need to know the subsidiary, which is each individual customer, how much they owe me. But sometimes you just want to get the report. What's outstanding? You want to know if I collect that $3,000 in the next 2 weeks, am I good? Or even if I do collect the $3,000, did I still lose? So there's the general overview, and there's the forest view and the tree view. And the same thing is the opposite what they deal with vendors and bills. You want to know what's my total outstanding bills from all types of vendors. Doesn't make a difference what type of account, what I'm buying, and you want to know what is, you know, individual, and people prioritize. You know, sometimes you might prioritize to pay bills from vendors which you need to be on good terms with because they extend you good credit, they give you a good price. There's some people that give you a cheaper rate when you're paying in a shorter period of time and you want to take advantage. Some people pay, you know, 2% off if you pay within 30 days, otherwise you got to pay full amount. You definitely want to be making use of that 2% credit. What version of that we're using. So again, I would say anything from 2019, if you go to, let me see if I get you a link and I'll post it now. Thank you for the visuals. Okay, so is expense account a good thing or a bad thing? Well, and expenses are inevitable. The best expense is cost of goods. Why I say it's good, because that expense you're definitely recouping. You're going to sell something for more than your cost. Sales expenses are also very good. If you can put advertising expense, it's good because advertising drives sales. If you don't advertise at all, you will make less money. And if you make $1 more in sales because of your advertising, that means if you invested $10,000 in advertising and you made $10,000 on $1 sales, the business made a dollar more than sales. Now, there's, you have to take into account everything. When I say that you made $1 more, it's taking into account the cost of the advertising, the work, not just the ad. If you spend $10,000 in ads and you only made $10,000 on $1 in sales, that's no good, because you have people in the company tied up creating ads and their time is money. And you have to take that all into account as part of the ad. People, your web graphic designer is part of your advertising expense, not just the print ad. And again, but sale, it's better than dead weight. Overhead is necessary, but that is not such a good expense as sales, because you feel that when you are doing advertising, there's a return on that expense. And overhead, you feel sometimes that it's a waste of money, because if you didn't live in an expensive area, your cost for your showroom would be cheaper than some other place. And again, maybe the fact that you're in an expensive area, that itself is advertising, and that is bringing you more customers. If you live in a desert and you have a 10,000 square foot showroom for $10, but you have no one coming there to buy, so that would also be a waste. What is the webinar ID? Okay. You could use QuickBooks to say 2016 if you have. There are new features. A lot of the things are the same as far as accounts and everything else, but I'm sure there'll be things that are in the new software that are not in the 2016. Pro Plus, that's, you know, just a fancy name. It's probably the generic version. So someone wants to see the other side with debits and credits. Again, I can show you the other side, but you see right here on my shared screen, you have here the plus and the minus. It's there for a reason. It's to tell you that assets will go up with the credit and down with, will go up with the debit, down with the credit. One second. Hello? I'm reviewing right now the chat questions. So I finished the presentation. And by the last two, three chats, actually, it seems like it's growing. Yeah. And utilities is necessary. We'll get into the bad expenses and good expenses. Wait, how do I fly down a second? I see it. No, equity, okay. Someone helped out with the equity here. Moment. Okay, if anyone likes the previous slides, I could give also those previous slides to everybody as well. I said the free trial is a month, but if you're not evaluating the same software, you're going two versions, I believe you could get a second month on that. I said buying products are expenses if it's being used up right away. Otherwise, it's first an asset, whether it's furniture, whether it's inventory. I'm in the 950. Chats, let's see what's left. I guess I came to the end if it pushed me back to the beginning. One more message. So it gives him. Again, if you are in college, you can get 4 or 5 months. I know that, but we are not registered. This program is not registered as a college. Mm. Okay, let's see if now I'm going to stop sharing screen now. And well, 1 second. One last question. I think we finished the question. Well, thank you very much for joining. I'm going to just, the link will come, the link for the QuickBooks will come in a different, in the email, in the follow-up email. And hopefully everyone will be able to install that software by themselves, which will be explanatory. Maybe we'll take, if anyone had difficulty, they could, maybe we'll take 5 minutes in the beginning just to make sure that their QuickBooks are installing. Again, I wish I could give you the 4 month free version, but that's the students and colleges. Otherwise, every person can get a free evaluation for a month. We are not a college right now. It's possible we could become affiliated with a college, but that's beyond the scope of this public forum right now. Regarding recordings, again, I recommend that you should follow up with Ben Wordy. And thank you very much for joining. Have a good night, everyone, and looking forward to seeing you on Wednesday about 8 p.m. Let's see here.